predictive value of T67 receiving the patients, because you see that the magnitude of the benefit of letrozole over tamoxifen in this population of patients, it becomes apparent only for higher T67 immunolabeling. And the higher is the T67 immunolabeling, the larger is the benefit of letrozole as compared to tamoxifen. So, likely, we should learn how to use T67 as a continuous variable instead of trying to identify the size of the cutoff. So, my take home message. There is no doubt that T67 is a useful prognostic marker in this cancer. Maybe the cutoff would be 25% in order to distinguish between nominal A and nominal B, best fitting the difference between nominal A's and nominal B's. But likely also, we should try and learn how to use T67 as a continuous variable. It is important to note that T67, besides being prognostic, may also be predictive in some specific subgroups of patients. And of course, this prognostic and predictive value will be magnified when we will use T67 in combination with other markers, for instance, progesterone receptor. This was my last slide, and I want to thank you for your attention. Since we know that tumors that would be ER negative and ER positive are exceptional, and since we know that there is a risk that we have false assessment of ER, false negative assessment, we are using PR as an alarm whenever we see ER negative tumors. Having ER positive tumors will tell us that something is wrong with ER. So this is to be the most important use of PR. And then we use PR in combination with T67, especially for those intermediate values of T67. So adding PR may help us in important degree.
Yes, yes.
Thank you very much for your excellent talk. That's great. You said evaluation of AI-67 takes maximum 15 minutes. But how long do you take in average? What's your average time in evaluation of like AI-67?
Well, that was the 15 minutes was derived from what we did, actually. We did in the core biopsy, because we have distributed core biopsy in 22 different labs. And every pathologist in these labs has taken note of the time spent. And 15 minutes was the average time. I'm old enough to have maybe 8 minutes, 9 minutes, but the younger people, they take longer. So I think 15 minutes is a reasonable estimate of the time that we take to count, but I'm telling you, we are counting cells. We are using, you know, that machine for blood counting that we press, okay. So using that kind of apparatus, we are counting 500 cells.
It is very nice, but I had are signing like 3 biopsies a day, and we will give you 3 hours just to examine the hair, which most people feel it's a little too long. So this is one of the reasons that it's not very extensively used in that.
Okay, but let us consider what is the end product. If we are giving information that is clinically relevant, that may help to inform the systemic treatment, what is 15 minutes? I mean, those people that are looking at fish for whatever you like, the pool, the translocation, etc., sometimes they spend half an hour, or maybe more, in order to get an information that is clinically useful. So, I don't think that we should measure or evaluate our activity based on how much does it cost, how much does it require. If this is clinically useful in order to perform the systemic treatment, I don't think that we should be afraid of 15 minutes. This is my sense.
I completely agree. I'm just giving you the reality of practice. There are many people who are because of
but it's interesting.
I'm They send most of the cases to Oncotype, and it is including the I-67.
Absolutely.
So this is why actually it was not popular in our institution as well.
Yeah. But it's true, all those molecular assays, they are mainly based on proliferation markers. Because if you take all the genes that are proliferation related from all of those signatures, you will lose any prognostic and predictive value of the signatures. So there is no doubt that the proliferation of the tumor cells is the leading force for prognosis and prediction. And again, there is no direct comparison, as far as I know, in the material from clinical trials comparing the assay, the molecular assays, and the immunohistochemistry. We will have it from both from the table X and from the mind map, because we will have the molecular assays, and on the same tissue we will have central pathology reading done. And it would be a good opportunity to evaluate the relative merits of the two approaches. And the last point that I wanted to emphasize is that it is 15 minutes, maybe more than 15 minutes if you like, but then in terms of costs, of course, you are comparing 15 minutes of the pathologist with $4,000 of the molecular assay. And this may be done everywhere in the world, and the molecular assays, some of them are centralized. So there's a lot of things to be considered. But you have seen that Hayes is a member of the panel, and then Hayes is the worst enemy on Ki-67, but still is involved in the group, and he's been proactive for now. So maybe the next ASCO recommendation will be a bit more fair with Ki-67.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Bialy, and you have to shift now to the next presentation. We have to have the pleasure which will give a thought about the use of immunohistochemistry in breast pathology.